Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
How do you do, my friend? Welcome to the program. I pray that this time together will really help you grow in grace and in knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's God's passion for our lives. I pray that it's my passion and yours as well. Right now, my Bible is sitting open to the book of Ruth in chapter 4. Ruth chapter 4, if at all possible, reach over, pick up your own copy of the Word of God and join me there in Ruth in chapter 4. I'll begin to read at verse 3 here in just a moment. And in a moment, I'm also going to be encouraging you to get from us a free sample packet containing one each of all of our English gospel tracts. I've got one of those gospel tracts here in my hand right now. And just in case you do not know what a gospel tract is, that tract is T-R-A-C-T. That's how you spell it. It's a reference to an evangelism tool. It's a short written presentation of what God says you and I must do to be saved from our sin and have the gift of eternal life given to us as a gift purchased by Jesus when he died on the cross, shed his blood, was buried, and rose again the third day. I'm going to highlight this track here in just a moment, but I want to lead into our Bible study time this way. Every American person and every American schoolchild ought to know the name of Eleanor Roosevelt. She was born in 1884 and died in 1962. She was the wife of President Franklin Roosevelt, and she was appointed as a United States representative to the United Nations when the UN was being formed. Well, at the UN's early meetings, Mrs. Roosevelt was put on committee number 3. That was the Humanitarian, Social, and Cultural Concerns Committee. They put her there basically to keep her out of the way. Well, when her committee first met, there was no agenda. There was no goals. So Eleanor took the bull by the horns and she set the agenda. She did that because here's what she knew. The person who frames the debate will almost always win the debate. I say that because today in Ruth chapter 4, there's a court case going on, and Boaz, the plaintiff, he is going to set the debate, and by so doing, he ends up winning the court case. Oh, by the way, that committee that Eleanor was on at the UN, it ended up being the most prominent committee in the very early years of the United Nations. Well, here in Ruth 4, Boaz is going to end up a very prominent man, all due because he framed the debate. I've got a gospel tract here in my hand. This one is entitled, I Have Plenty of Time. Now, each and every one of our gospel tracts is aimed at a target audience. This tract, I Have Plenty of Time, is aimed at teenagers, at young people who think they have all kinds of time to have fun and kick up their heels before they need to get serious. Well, this tract begins with a story, a true story about a 19-year-old gal named Mary. She heard the gospel at a gospel meeting. She had her heart touched. She was urged to receive Christ, but postponed it because that night she had some fun to have first before she got serious about her soul. The trouble is she died that night in a car accident, and that story is used to be a warning that we need to take serious the condition of our soul today. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. One of the verses that's prominent in this gospel tract is Hebrews 9:27. It says, "It is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment." Mary missed an opportunity to have her soul cleansed from her sin because fun was more important to her at that moment in her life. Have you postponed getting saved because, well, you have things to do? today is the day you need to get serious about your soul. And more importantly than getting serious, you need to have salvation come to your soul through Jesus Christ. Get these tracts from us, please. We want to give you a free sample packet. At the end of the broadcast, my announcer will give you our contact information. If you'll give us your name and address, we'll send that to you free of charge. You can go to our website, which is BibleTractsInc.org, and order the sample packet there. If your Bible's open to Ruth chapter 4, I begin at verse 3, it says this, "And he, Boaz, said unto the kinsmen, Naomi is come out again from the country of Moab, selleth a parcel of land, which was our brother Elimelech's. And I thought to advertise thee, saying, Buy it before the inhabitants and before the elders of my people. If thou wilt redeem it, redeem it. But if thou wilt not redeem it, then tell me that I may know, for there is none to redeem it besides thee, and I am after thee. And he said, I will redeem it. Then said Boaz, Wah, what day thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must buy it also of Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to raise up a name of the dead unto his inheritance. Oh, and the kinsman said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar mine own inheritance. Redeem thou thy right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it. Stop, please, right there. On Monday's broadcast, I gave my larger three-point outline for chapter 4 here of the book of Ruth. Verses 1 through 12 is the first point of that outline, and I titled it, A Redeemer Sought. A Redeemer Sought. And as I began to walk through these 12 verses, I used a series of words beginning with the letter C, like on the word cat. In verses 1 and 2, I called it the court or the court room. In that day, in that era, the city gates were where the legal matters, most of them, were settled. Now, my key word for verses 3 and 4 is the case. The case. Boaz here states the case to be decided at the court session. And for the first time here in verse 3, we learn that Naomi has property. She owns it, but she needs to sell it, more than likely to provide money for her long-term coming years. Well, women owning property in that day may surprise some people. Sometime, go and reread Proverbs chapter 31 again. There, the godly lady talked about there, she buys and sells property. Women are pretty smart people. They can be even pretty smart business people. Boaz makes the case here in verses 3 and 4 that Naomi has property to sell, and it needed to remain in the same tribal unit, and the man who is confronted by Boaz is the one with the first rights to purchase the land. He's the closest family member, so he has the first right to purchase or to refuse to purchase the land. So the case is made in verses 3 and 4 that this unknown man should buy the land. My next C word is the word condition in verse 5. The condition. Once the case is open, we see that this unnamed man wants to buy the field. Well, evidently he had the financial ability to do it. But there was a condition stated in verse 5. Here is where Boaz frames the debate. Along with buying the property, he says, this unnamed man will also have to marry Ruth, the wife of the dead man who owns the property, and this unnamed man will have to then raise up children through Ruth to keep the dead husband's name going on generation by generation. Well, but now look at verse 6. My word for verse 6 is the word cannot. Cannot. The kinsman there says, I cannot redeem it lest I mar mine own inheritance. This man says he can't do it because he can't redeem the property and he can't have children with Ruth or he's going to mar the present inheritance that he has. Now, we're not told why his inheritance would be marred. That word marred means to spoil, to ruin, or to corrupt, but it most likely means that this man was already married and had children, and thus to add more heirs to his estate when he would die, that would weaken this man, the property he had to pass on to his own children, and mar the children's future. He doesn't want to do that, so he says that he cannot redeem the land, plus take Ruth. Well, my next C word is the word confirmation, based upon verses 7, 8, and 9. Confirmation. If you read those, you're going to find that the man takes off his shoe and gives it to Boaz. Now, that was a symbol in that day. That was a symbol that Boaz now not only can buy the property, but he can walk on it as his own. Again, it was all part of the culture of the day. Now, there's two more words I want to point out here that begin with the letter C. One, based upon verses 9 and 10, is the word commitment. Boaz makes a commitment. And then verses 11 and 12 is the conclusion. For time's sake, let me just talk about the commitment of Boaz based upon verses 9 and 10. He commits himself to three things. Number one, he commits to redeem, to buy the property. Number two, he commits to receive Ruth. He will marry her. She will be his bride. He will take this once cursed woman and totally alter her status. And then number three, Boaz commits to raise up a future generation. He will provide long-term hope to Ruth. Now, in these three commitments, I once more see Boaz displaying Christ. I see him as a picture of Jesus. Jesus came out of love and committed himself to redeem sinners, to purchase sinners out of their marred, out of their condemned state. Boaz is acting out of love for Ruth. Jesus came, and God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. But then Jesus gives to all redeemed ones long-term hope. It's called eternal life. So Boaz came to redeem. Jesus came to redeem. Then Boaz makes Ruth his bride. Jesus makes sinners his bride. And then Jesus came to redeem and give us long-term hope called eternal life. Now, you and I who have been redeemed by Jesus Christ, we get to spend forever and ever in God's presence and enjoying his person forever and ever. Dear friend, is Jesus your redeemer? Have you been purchased out of your sin prison? The Bible says that sin, the wages of sin, is death. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So we all stand not just guilty, but spiritually dead in our sin, captive in that condition, just like Ruth was viewed as a Moabite, as being a cursed woman. We have a curse of breaking the law of God stamped upon our life, and we are hopelessly placed there and cannot on our own get out of it. We need a redeemer. Boaz loved Ruth, and so he provided redemption. Jesus loves sinners, so he came and he died on the cross, shed his blood, because without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. Friend, if you've never received Christ, then you're not redeemed. You need to receive Jesus as your Savior, Redeemer. You need to receive him today, because today is the day of salvation.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888, and our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve him.